Hey, this is Brian coming to you live from the Ice House Comedy Club here in Pasadena, California, where once or sometimes twice a week we get together and we do a live podcast in one room. In the other room, we do this, which is like a green room where we all sit around and talk shit about the audience. Coming this week, if you are anywhere near the San Diego area, check out DeathSquad.tv. We will be at a comedy club there for Comic-Con called the American Comedy Co. And tickets are still available for one or two of the shows. But for any of these Ice House shows, you just go to IceHouseComedy.com and search for Death Squad. And tonight we have another super show. And to the right of me, my co-host, the beautiful and talented Joseph Rogan.
Powerful Brian Redband. We got Pete the Grower in the motherfucking house. We got Dom Irrera. Greg Fitzsimmons is all up in this bitch. We're finna get crazy.
Ow.
Dom Irrera and I were enjoying the new music that these youngsters play at the pool hall these days. It was a wonderful department from what we normally enjoy.
I was telling Joe that, I said, look at us. Like, all these guys are having fun and clowning around. I said, we're the only comedians here. We're such sullen, stone-faced.
Stone-faced.
Once in a while, we'd say something to each other. That was about it.
Yeah, we'd be like, God, this song sucks. They would be like, oh, we'd say to each other, just fucking terrible dance music. The future's bleak. The
wait,
music.
Motherfucker.
It's not that much good stuff out there. Damn.
It's really disorienting when you see a room full of people enjoying something that you can't access in
any
way.
At all. Yeah.
These drunken
girls. I don't hear Greg.
Yeah, try again, Greg. What I was saying was that it's disorienting. You see, like, there's an energy in the room that everybody's into. It's almost like when you're at a concert and everyone's fucking waving their arms and you're going like, I appreciate this music, but I'm not experiencing what these people are experiencing.
Right.
You feel lonely.
Yeah.
Well, we had these.
That is a weird thing with they're like, it's like if you're at a gospel show, everybody's going crazy. Yeah, and you're like, man, I'm not fucking feeling this.
Yeah.
You guys are speaking in tongues. And I'm like, all right.
Yeah. Why aren't I human?
The wave. Yeah, there's some people that will go nuts for music that you can't fucking stand. Mm-hmm. I have tried to wrap my head around like Grateful Dead shows. I've tried to wrap my head around Fish. I've tried. I lack a chromosome. I don't know what it is. I can't get that music. I find a few of Grateful Dead songs to be really cool. Like Shades of Grey was good. Truckin' is a good song. They got a lot of great songs. They were brilliant musicians. But those long, crazy jam sessions, like, I don't
you
understand.
You did it without drugs, clearly. If you go to a live show and
if you're on drugs, it's amazing.
It's really, I mean, you are never, there is no odd man out who's not
Grateful Dead
on drugs. Yeah.
Yeah.
At a show.
Yeah, that was my scene for a long time. I managed a Grateful Dead band for 4 or 5 years, like 500 shows.
My cousin followed them around the country, and they would sell like scrambled eggs from the back of their truck. They had like a Subaru, like station wagon truck, and it was so sad. She was like super hippied out, man. She was like a normal kid, and she just got like crazy deaded out and followed them around forever.
And everybody thinks they're like lazy hippies. It's like, no, look at the people in that parking lot. They're making fucking omelets.
Yeah.
And they're making
hustlers.
Hemp
swinging
shoes.
Beers.
They just decided that they like this culture better than the rest of society, and they decided that they want to follow around this utopian sort of lifestyle. And why not, man? Yeah. They're making their bacon and eggs, whatever.
Yeah.
While you're young,
see, that's
at least.
Way before my time,
is it?
You kids.
If she's, you know, she was young, she eventually got out of it, but she did it for years, man. It's amazing, you know.
They
think
all
about
end up
that.
On Wall Street. Those deadheads.
Yeah, they do a total 180. You sons
of
bitches.
Because a lot of them come from money. They come from like prep schools.
Oh wow.
In New England.
Yeah, that's how they could afford
guilty
to go on
white
tour
money.
All the
what's
time.
Up, Tony?
Yeah.
Dad's money.
Yep. Tony Hinchcliffe's all up in this motherfucker.
Heck yeah. How are you?
Good. We were just talking about people with money. What do they do?
they can actually afford to go on tour with the dead.
Yeah.
You know, and they can afford to just like know that when they come back, there's still a job in dad's company. So
yeah.
So they can go out a little bit.
Yeah. I'm sure there's a lot of that, right? You know, the just initial going crazy after leaving the nest.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah, it's almost in some countries. Well, the Amish have it.
Yeah, what do they call it? Rumshackle or something like that?
Rum.
What is it called?
Rumspringer.
Rumspringer? Is that it?
Yeah,
I think you might be right. Are you right? Is that it? Yeah. Yeah, it's that movie documentary about it. I think it's called The Devil's Playground.
Uh-huh.
Is that what it's called? But it's all about these kids who they have their little time off when they're allowed to separate themselves from the ideals of the church, and they go fucking bananas. They fuck themselves into comas. They drink and party until, like, literally, they're so depleted. Their immune systems are shot. They're fucking exhausted,
it's like
dehydrated.
Spring break without any cans.
And they're like, let's just go back to the church and go back to the Mormon ways and make our own butter. They just fucking totally tap out.
How long do they have off for?
I don't know, but they can't handle it.
I think it's 2 years.
Is it 2 years?
Like there's a reality show now called Amish Out of the Order.
Oh my God.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. And then, you know, they document the kids, what they're doing, making the choice whether they want to stay or go.
The fact that someone's still rocking the Amish way in 2012. Like,
in a carriage?
My goodness, that's silly.
It's crazy. None of the other Amish people probably know that it's like on. Because they don't even
the
have
the TV
TVs.
Show, yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, that's true.
Is that true? Are they completely
they don't have electricity.
Outside of electricity now?
No electricity.
Nothing.
But they're allowed to use like weed eaters, but not drive cars. It's a weird thing.
I thought they varied. I thought there was like they
varied.
Well,
there's Mennonites.
Oh, really?
Who have
right.
altered rules, but.
Okay, that's what we saw. You remember, Brian, when we were in Boston and Ari walks up to these Mennonites and goes, what kind of cult are you in? And it was like these poor fucking lost people, and they had these glassy eyes. I'm like, Ari, you can't talk to them like that, man.
Fuck it, they're idiots. Look at them. I was talking to these Hasidic Jews on a plane, and the guy was normal. And I was, you know, I expected, like, and he was just, like, talking to me normally. Hey, how you doing? You know, and it was, like, so weird. The family and the kids were cute, and they were all just dressed. It was like they're from a time warp.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I just was so surprised at how normal they were. I wanted to talk to them more. I'm thinking, why do you wear this getup? You're normal.
I think a lot of it is just to appease the family. You know, after a while, it must be ridiculous. If you're a thinking man, after a while, you're like, why do I got to grow these fucking Jerry curls for? What's up with me with this outfit?
Who is it? I read this article about this woman who was Jewish, but like, you know, not raised religiously Jewish as much as like culturally Jewish. And she got to a certain age, and she was living in Brooklyn in a Hasidic neighborhood.
Is this microphone picking up?
Yeah.
Do you hear it? You hear it?
Yeah. And she just decided, she got interested in their culture, and decided to go Hasidic, which is odd for a modern woman, because the women are very, you know, oppressed in that world. But she just decided she was going to live by these rules, and she has been doing it for 10 years.
Did I really fuck through a sheet?
Yeah, well, that's supposedly the move. Yeah,
that is hot.
Put a little hole in the sheet.
Just a sheet turns them on.
It's so crazy. But apparently, those dudes are like really into getting hookers.
Really?
Yeah.
Imagine a hooker walking in and seeing a guy in that getup. I don't need the money that bad. I'm out of here.
But that is what they say, that those dudes get a lot of hookers, especially in New York. In New York, it's a big thing.
So they're bringing venereal diseases home to the wife who's
maybe
beyond pure.
I don't know. The whole thing's a mess.
I stopped with the hookers. I was addicted to that for a couple of years.
Really?
I stopped because I took blood pressure medication, which lowered my libido enough where I just feel like Irish. I mean, I have a normal sex drive.
So what Holy happens shit, if that's I take funny. Those drugs?
You'll die.
You become a half a queer.
Your dick will like go into your body like a turtle's head.
Yeah, it's halfway there. I don't have the drive I used to. It's amazing. I mean, I used to wish I could cut a ball off because I couldn't focus on anything. And now I'm finally at that age where it's like probably appropriate, my sex drive. For how often I really have sex, I'm interested when I'm having sex.
I'm not as
distracted as I used to.
It's just funny why it exists. It exists all the time because babies were dying like crazy. Mm. You had to make them as much as possible. You had to make them every chance you could. You had to sneak them in all the time. Then eventually, people started talking. They figured out language. By then, you know, women had corralled men into trying to like just stay only with them, and guys sort of gave into it. But before then,
we were sea turtles.
Wild animals.
Yeah.
Just fucking, and jaguars were eating our babies. So that's why you keep this crazy fucking sex drive deep into your 40s.
That's why the jaguars are all dying today.
They don't eat babies as much.
Not enough babies running around.
Baby humans are about the easiest shit to catch.
Delicious.
If you're a big cat. Yeah, they shot a cat in Ottawa this week. They thought they were extinct. They hadn't seen one there since the 1800s.
And jaguar? People,
no. A mountain lion. Big mountain lion. Big one. Yeah, and they thought they were extinct for like almost 200 years.
And they shot it?
Yeah, they shot it and killed it.
Oh.
Big one. Dangerous. Big one. Been
they
eating cows.
They couldn't tranquilize it and save its life?
It's eating things, bro. They'd found a hunting ground. Eating dogs, eating cows. You know.
They shot one out here in California about 2 weeks ago.
Santa Monica. Did you see that one? Yeah, in Santa Monica. And it was amazing because there's this one. I have people in my life that I call them science projects. It's like people that I only follow because they're fucking retarded. And I just want to know their take on anything. And this lady, this one lady, she's like super vegan, crazy lady. And she always like says all like really super negative thing about people who eat meat. And it's always like really ridiculous. So I went right to her thing as soon as the mountain lion got shot, and she was like, "We are so arrogant to think that our life is worth more than an animal. I would gladly take a bullet for mountain lion or a deer before I would a person." She said, "I wish there was a type of AIDS that only killed people that ate meat."
Oh,
wow.
I was crying, laughing. I'm like, is this bitch a troll? This is so good. She's so good. She's like a character. And you just look at her face, just pale, not enough vitamins, all sadness, too many cats, toxoplasma on the fucking brain.
It's funny because your vision of a vegetarian is that they're gentle and loving. I wish there was an AIDS. Kill meat eaters.
I like the vegetarians who only eat fish and sometimes chicken.
Well, you know what?
What kind of vegetarian are you?
I've heard people say that they
the healthy one.
They eat fish because fish don't take care of their young.
How do you know how fish like that? How do you know how they feel? How do they like jumping into a hook? You know, like they talk about the feelings of an animal.
What do you think it's easier? Jumping into a hook is easier than getting killed by a bear, isn't it? No, the bear just eats you right away. We wait around a while. You put you on a fucking little thing, a clip, and throw you into the water. And you're trying, you know, we want to keep you alive as long as possible so you're nice and fresh when we cut your fucking head off.
Reveal. We're just going to hang you on the wall like art.
Well, you know about foie gras being illegal.
They jam the thing down the goose's neck.
It's not even the jam. They just open the goose's neck. The goose doesn't have a gag mechanism, and they all line up around the feeding thing. Like, they want the food. Like, when if that was to you, if they pumped the food down your gullet, it would be terrible. But for a goose, it's awesome. You know, it's not, like, ideal. They would rather eat it once at a time. It's uncomfortable for them, for you to control them. But once they get the shit, they all hover around that machine. Like, they want to eat. It's not a person that you're doing that to. And it's not like geese and ducks are endangered, nor is it illegal to eat them. So you get to a crazy thing. It becomes, well, you're not allowed to force feed them and make their livers big, but you're allowed to do anything else you want to them, including kill them and eat them.
Well, I love that they have no gag reflex. If we could crossbreed Amish women during the Ramadan with a goose with
the
no
Ramadan.
Gag reflex.
Rump Springer, man. You shouldn't even say that. You can get in trouble, man. People will get mad at you.
Just an Amish woman who just can
just
suck
wants
it
to
suck
just
it for
go
2 years.
To war. Go to war on your cock and balls for 2 years.
Just inhale protein as she turns paler and paler.
Just been thinking about it, nothing but since she was 13. Imagine waiting for that fateful day when she's freedom. Yeah. She's like fucking Braveheart, man.
Yeah. You wear a shirt with a color on it, she loses her shit.
Yep.
What happened to this conversation? How do we
dives
get,
on the
how do we
dick.
Get here?
Amish girls, it's their fault. Yeah.
Yeah.
I bet they're like Catholic girls squared.
Oh, yeah.
Catholic school girls? Mm. Is there a dirtier species?
No, it's the skirt. The skirt makes
animals.
Them bad.
Yep. Animals. And they're all competing with all the other girls in the rooms without any interaction with boys all day. So it's a mad sprint to dick as soon as the fucking bell rings.
Yep. Yeah. Oh, yeah. And the guys
right?
are, too.
Hold on.
So
let me
that's
write that down. Sprint to dick.
That's
Joe
what it
Rogan
is.
Says.
I dated a girl who was the freakiest bitch I ever dated in my life. And it was when we were in high school. I went to a regular high school. And she went to an all-girls Catholic school. And she was crazy. The girl, she was so sexual. It was nuts.
Did you ever get a girl that like asked you to smack her and hit me harder, you motherfucker?
No. I've never had a girl ask me to hit her.
I've had where I just couldn't hit her harder.
Wow.
Only because I wasn't strong enough. I was mean enough.
Are you serious?
You say, can I call Joe Rogan to come over?
Joe Rogan to kill her.
No, I've never hit a girl. I had a girl that I dated when I was in my early 20s that had this weird rape thing. Where she would want to pretend that I was raping her. And I was like, how do I know if I'm really I can't just pretend. Like, how far are we going with this?
Yeah.
She was like, as far as we have to go. Like, whoa, all right, stop. See, I don't want to get boners, future boners.
You're
based
in prison.
On this.
She's like, no, keep going. The fantasy's not over.
So weirded me out. It was too bad, too, because other than that, she was fucking wild.
Yeah,
it
was
fun.
I was doing this scene. I went to acting school, and it was the scene that Farrah Fawcett did. In
Burning Bed?
Yes.
Yeah.
And it's a rape scene. And my fucking acting coach teacher gives me and this chick, Deja, this hot Puerto Rican chick from Brooklyn.
Oh, my God.
And I'm supposed to do this rape scene with her. And so we're rubbing against each other. And he said, look, this isn't working. You guys, I don't feel any real... Here's the keys to the studio. Come in here on an off day and get fucking crazy. Get it out of your system so that you can be real in the moment.
Oh my God.
So we go into the room, and I mean, she's got big tits and big fat Puerto Rican lips, and we're making out because it's sort of like
makes her,
and so, and we're grinding, and then I'm supposed to
grab her. Was it just you two alone?
Just two of us alone, and I could not release into that reality because I was afraid I wouldn't be able to stop.
Right. You were afraid you'd pull your dick out and actually start fucking her.
And I didn't think, if I'd known then, that you'd come up with a safe word. If we had a safe word, yeah. I would have done it.
Pecans, what if she never pecans. Said that safe word? It's just like, oh, puppy. Oh, shit. Oh, you getting all up in that pussy. Oh, shit, Gregory.
She's saying the safe word in Spanish.
You getting up all in that shit, puppy. Oh, shit, Gregory.
Man.
About to bust inside me, Gregory.
I did that scene, actually. I don't think I could rape anybody because, first of all, I don't know if I could stay hard, you know, with somebody screaming because I feel I have too much compassion. I can't. I'd be like the apologetic rapist. Are you okay? I really like to continue this, but if you're gonna fucking, if you're really crying, I'm sorry.
Well, I think I'll
stop.
What's scary is it?
Can you give us a description of the rapist? Yeah, he was crying. Good flowers.
What's scary is that you can get locked into some sort of crazy pattern of doing shit like that at an early age.
Yeah,
if you have the wrong combination of things happen, like if you have some abuse in your past and you run into a girl who has some abuse and maybe there's some drugs or alcohol involved, you can all of a sudden develop like weird ball gag type fetishes.
You heard about this thing with Tosh, the Laugh Factory, right?
What exactly happened?
Okay.
He was making a joke about rape.
What happened was, what I saw, it was my fault he went on because I was busting his balls. He came in to get something to eat with me, and we're going out. I go, why don't you go on? He goes, I don't want to go on. I go, bring up Tosh, just busting his balls. Now, they didn't see him, so he could have not gone on. So then they start screaming. They bring up Daniel, and he's just trying out some bits. He was not prepared to go on. And he said something about rape, and this lady goes, rape's not funny. There's nothing funny about rape. And he says, well, wouldn't it be funny if you got gang raped right now? Something like that.
Right.
Now, obviously, he's fucking kidding.
Of course.
You know, of course he's kidding. And the thing is, like, I did two TV shows today to try and put out the fire, two news shows. And
I'm going, what? You did?
Yeah.
Because it's that big of a deal?
It's that big of a deal. I mean, people are calling me from New York, you know, and it's Twittered all over the world.
Oh, my God. The woman was a heckler. She's scum of the earth.
That's what I said. Yeah. And the thing is, I said, do you really think? And I said, ask the women here who know him, that how he treats them with respect. Do you really think that he's not kidding? Do you ever hear of a joke?
God, especially dealing with someone who's heckling him. You can't, you know, look, if you can't talk about any subject, this is you never know what someone can do with a subject. Well, to say that subject is off bounds, fuck you.
Or to tell
fuck
a comedian something's
exactly.
not funny, you're a heckler.
She's a piece of shit. She should be boiled in wino piss.
Now you're gonna
fuck her. Fuck that dumb cunt, that mouthy cunt. It's pointless to even entertain her. She should have never been talking. She should be fired from comedy clubs. They should say you can't come back anymore. You suck at being a comedy club patron. That's what should happen. They should take a picture of her like this. Take a picture of her, put it on every comedy club all over the country. Mm-hmm. We get it. We can't let you in. Sorry. Keep your $15. Fuck you. Fuck you, lady. You want to yell out, you can't tell out a rape joke. Most rape jokes aren't funny. You're right. But I've heard a few fucking really funny rape jokes in my day. I really have.
Remember the line?
They're unfortunate, but they're funny.
You were the reason I kept the line in because you liked it. We were in Montreal. Remember the line? About my cousin, I said he was talking about date rape.
And
I go, well, I'm not saying date rape is good, but it is better than the regular rape. Because at least you get like a nice dinner and a movie. the regular rape, you know, the pull.
I love that
song. Bushes, but you were the reason I kept it in because you
really.
Go, yeah, you said you know regular rape is funny.
It's so
you know?
Funny. It's such a great line. Yeah, the regular rape.
As if we all know exactly what that is.
Okay, so right there, perfect. perfect example. You cannot say that's not a funny rape joke. That's a funny fucking rape joke. It's not advocating rape. It's just it's a part of reality.
Yeah,
it's a part of reality, and you had a very funny line. And it's, you know, it's not mean spirited in any way, shape, or form.
No, it's just stupid.
It's
and
just
ignorant.
Stupid as fuck. You can't say rape is never funny. Fuck you. Go away.
It does hurt doing it at comedy clubs, though. I gave up on my rape joke, even though I thought it was funny.
Well, son, rape jokes are black belt material.
Yeah.
And you really should be fucking with like some purple belt shit right now.
Right.
You really don't need to be fucking it with just rape. Seems don't like, say the word nigger on stage
Yeah, but
either.
It just seems like, you know, just with that right? that word, that there's a lot of people that in the audience that probably got raped by their uncle or father. And then it just ruins their whole night just even talking about it.
Yeah, you know, remember DJ Hazard?
Yeah.
Sure.
DJ Hazard gave me that advice once, and I didn't listen because I was too cocky and stupid back then. But he gave me that advice. He goes, if you can change like something like that, like he goes, I used to have a line about a child molesting clown. He goes, but then I thought about it, like how many fucking kids have been molested? And that would immediately like pucker them up in their tracks. He goes, so I just changed it to something clown, you know, like, you know, whatever the fuck he decided.
I remember the song.
Yeah, I don't remember what the line he changed it. He just took out that part.
Yeah.
And I thought about it. I was like, well, yeah, I guess so. But to me, I was a mercenary back then. I was like, but I know this is going to get a laugh. So those people who got molested are going to have to go fuck themselves. Like a joke to me was worth too much. Like if I had a joke that was good.
Yeah.
If it just happened to be that somebody got molested in the joke. Yeah. Tough shit. It's got to get launched.
When you're starting out, it's a slippery slope because, I mean, I saw Joe start and it was literally 0 to 60 and your whole credo was, oh, yeah, you can't talk about that or this is inappropriate and you went all the way with it. So if you start cutting back on that early, well, how far are you going to pull back until all of a sudden you feel like, well, this isn't what I'm
You saw
doing.
Joe from the beginning?
Greg and I started out like maybe a week apart from each other or something. Yeah. We used to do a lot of gigs together. We drove all over Hell's Creation.
Okay.
Doing all the, we did Barry Katz's gigs together. We did all sorts of little bar shows together.
And the open mic nights, showing up at 5 o'clock, signing up, going to get some food, hanging out.
Yeah, we were a part of the whole internet, or the whole open mic culture together, like at the exact same time. And McGuire, Chris McGuire.
I never saw you guys when you weren't good. Like me and Scroban,
we fucking terrible.
You know, Scroban, when you met, he was a producer at Everybody Loves Raymond, and we started out together, and we went through the growing pains. But by the time I met both of you, you were already there.
Well, I met you. I was still very shaky. I got to
brought you up in
you.
Montreal.
Yeah, I was fucking very shaky back then. I got lucky. I had a good set then, but it could have fucking gone off the track and into the woods.
Well, you were one of the few guys that came up to Boston from outside of Boston
I know.
And was accepted.
It was Kelly
Quinn. You.
They were good to me.
I can't think of too many other people.
I took a hot date to see Demerara. Stephanie Siegel. Well, she was
she
older
sounds
than
like
me.
She has big tits.
She they weren't big, but she was a beautiful lady. And I took her to Nick's Comedy Stop to
Did
see
I get
Demerara.
You laid, Joe?
Yeah.
I hope you played a part. I hope there was an assist. But it was awesome. It was you. What a show. It was you, Steve Sweeney, Don Gavin, and Kenny Rogerson.
Wow.
Holy shit, it was a fucking show.
And what people don't realize back then is I bet you Gavin hosted, usually the biggest name would host the show.
Yeah.
And he'd do a fucking great 15 up front, make him a crowd, bring each person up, and then close it out.
Yeah.
After all these killer acts, they would do another 15.
They tried not to bury me. They were so nice to me.
Oh, they loved
and,
you.
And like I remember the Richard Lewis, they tried to bury, and Sweeney.
Tried.
They
buried
did.
Him.
He hid behind the stage till
they
people
buried
left.
Him. Yeah. They buried him.
Sweeney actually said to him, follow that.
Wow.
Yeah. That's old school.
That's how it was up there.
It was a very competitive.
Darwinism.
Harsh atmosphere. That was a totally different kind of place to start out. Hmm. You know, Greg
Sweeney
and I
was the worst at that, though.
Who?
Sweeney was the worst?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he could
Sweeney
destroy.
He fucking enjoyed it.
And it was all Boston stuff. He would hit you with the local stuff, which you cannot follow. Because Boston people love laughing at Boston shit. They
Charleston
fucking
women
love
and all that.
Any Revere, girls from Revere. Yeah, I had like 15 minutes that was all Boston shit before I had 20 minutes. When I first started doing shows outside of Boston, I didn't have any time at all. All my time was like Boston jokes.
Yeah.
Because they were so potent. It was like a nice, cheap way to get a joke, you know?
Well, and that was the whole story with Stephen Wright, is that the producer of The Tonight Show, who was the guy who was the
Jim McCauley?
No, before that.
Freddie DiCordova?
No, after that.
Right in the middle.
No, Letterman, I mean.
Oh, Letterman.
No, okay.
Oh,
Marty? Barry Sands? He was a Tonight Show guy, and he flies out to Boston because he hears about all these amazing Marty? Comics, Lenny Clark and Sweeney.
Yeah.
So he's coming out because comedy's just starting to get on the Tonight Show, like in terms of this new modern type of stand-up. And he comes in, and they set up a showcase at the Ding Ho, which was like the original comedy club in Boston. Right. And he goes to the club, and one after the other, Sweeney, Gavin, they're all doing shots. They're doing local jokes. They're killing, but it's nothing you could see on the Tonight Show. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, Stephen Wright, who is the guy that they felt sorry for,
right,
goes up there and he does Stephen Wright, and they fly him out the next week. And then Johnny told him to stay in town, did a set the next week, and ended up doing like six in a year and became a superstar. And they're all sitting at the Ding Ho going, what the fuck? That guy can't fucking follow me.
That guy can't follow
at
me.
At the Ding Ho.
Yeah.
But,
but it's hard to write those six-minute sets. They're a bitch.
Oh, those fucking comedy shows that we got a chance to watch, we were a part of a weird part of comedy history. You know, those one guy hosting shows. So the Kevin Knox Show.
Yeah.
The Don Gavin Show.
Sweeney and me.
Steve Sweeney and friends. Yeah,
that's not right.
Oh, really?
Every was Saturday that? Night at
they were all like that, though. The DJ Hazard night at the Comedy Connection.
Yeah.
You know, it was always like that. Like, one guy would have a night.
Dennis Leary coming up, Panette. They had some great acts, man.
Oh, dude, when we were there, we got to see when Greg and I were open micers, was this crazy golden era where, like, you got to see the guys coming up, like Anthony Clark was hot. Like, Anthony Clark was killing him. He was one of the first guys that was, like, selling out clubs in Boston. And I don't know what
happened. Right out of college. He was just so fucking likable.
Yeah.
So likable and so charismatic. And, man, I'm really shocked that that guy had never became like a bigger name stand-up comedian, because
he kind of left it and went to that series and never came back.
That's
really
so weird, man. If you knew him back when we knew him, when he was killing in Boston, he looked like he was having so much fun up there.
Not only
it was
that,
fun.
He went to Broadway with Steppenwolf and did what's the Steinbeck one? Grapes of Wrath on Broadway and killed
really?
It. Got big reviews, and then he started doing great indie films with like River Phoenix. Did like three River Phoenix movies. And he was like the pedigree, and then all of a sudden he took sitcom jobs and he stopped doing stand-up, and it was like, whoa, man, he could have shot a lot higher.
I think he drinks a lot.
Yeah.
Because I know I drink a lot, and I see him drinking a lot with me. It's an indication.
Yeah, that's always sad when Dom is there at your intervention.
Yeah, right.
Things are bad.
Listen, you're like me, and I'm fucked up.
I've seen the warning signs firsthand. But speaking of Dennis Leary, I just came from the theater with my son seeing Spider-Man. Leary's fucking great.
Oh, is he?
It's so amazing
when
you see a guy. He's a good actor, man, and he's just playing this role that requires like that cartoonish quality, like it's drama, but you got to bring something to it that's a little bit almost hokey, and he just nails it.
He wasn't bad even in the end part when he gets killed. Like, you know, there's a hard. It's hard to pull off to be nice to my
daughter. Spoiler alert!
Did I spoil the fuck out of that?
A little bit.
My apologies. Look, we're under the influence. That's so rude. I really enjoyed
it's been the 2 weeks. They've
I really enjoyed the movie.
You were smoking dope too.
I don't think they have.
I had a half of one hit.
Damn.
That's
sorry.
All I need.
I really didn't mean to do that.
What is this $40 doing here?
That's for you, Dom Herrera, for being sexy and for being you.
Yeah.
Fuck. The kid who plays Spider-Man is very good.
Fuck yeah.
He's much better than Tobey Maguire in Spider-Man. I don't know why I said that. Maybe it's because I'm fucking jumping on the bandwagon. You know, Tobey's gone. Everybody's like, well, fuck Tobey. This new guy's better anyway.
Yeah.
It's like an automatic human instinct. Yeah. He's very good.
He's very good.
The
he's
acting
totally
is
different, though.
Very interesting. It's very interesting. I enjoyed it. They still can never make me buy the fucking web thing. The one thing I'm still like,
it's
come on.
Because you're
silly.
Watching, like, the villains can do all kinds of fucking insane shit, and all he has is gluey shit coming out of his wrist. After a while, after 10 fights, you're like,
yeah, and he got shot once. Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay. I don't mean to be doing this, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to stop talking about this.
I would highly
I thought he was really good, though. I thought Brian hated it. Reichel didn't like it at all. He said it was terrible. He said it was bad. I thought it was really good. I enjoyed it.
You know what I've been getting a lot of shit about? I did a little part in Raging Bull 2.
I saw that.
Now, you know, first of all, when I saw Raging Bull 2, I'm thinking, here's a movie that needed to be made. Because Raging Bull 1 wasn't good enough. You know, this needs a sequel to straighten things out. But I mean, it was like I was going, I don't, Raging Bull 2, I never, how could they?
What without, about The Godfather? De Niro, Godfather 2, you didn't have any faith?
But I mean, well, I mean, that was amazing that they did such great sequels. And it wasn't the same as The Godfather 1, but anyway, this is not Scorsese or De Niro, and it was good money.
Who
so
is
I
it?
Took, I don't know. Well, I mean, the guy, what's the guy's name? Forsythe, William Forsythe.
William Forsythe, the actor?
Yeah, Joe Mantegna.
They're the ones who are directing this?
No, no, they're the actors in it.
Oh, well, that's
it's a very good.
That's a good cast.
Penelope Ann Miller.
Wow.
Yeah, really good
actors. Those are really good.
Yeah, yeah.
Penelope Ann Miller always has this sort of like quiet, dirty thing going on. You know what I'm talking about?
She was staring me down, Joe.
She's sexy. Was she?
Right at the Irira weapon. Her eyes were
She's
riveting.
Probably seen your act, my friend. Oh, she's seen
that's
you
all
crush.
I got left. I kill, she's and it's seen a gift. You
crush.
I'm not bragging.
And when she died at the beginning of the movie, that was intense.
What? Don't tell them that.
Greg, what the fuck? Now we're making shit up, folks, just to balance it out. I apologize. Yeah, Penelope Ann Miller is hot as fuck. There's some girls that just have some weird, like, this is no, for no reason. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, you don't even know what it is. Like, her, she's got, like, a sexiness.
She's got it. Yeah, there's
You those. Know, you've kissed her, you'd be like, your dick would be like, oh, shit, for real?
Yeah.
Is this really going down, dude?
Yeah.
Sophie had that, I thought.
Your ex is very attractive.
Do you remember her?
The one with the French accent?
Yeah.
Yeah.
She had that fucking
she did.
Set. She would look so beautiful, it would look like it was blurry.
Yeah.
Like soft focus kind of beauty.
Yeah, like there was a glow. She had a glow about
and I,
her.
And I cheated on her with skanky chicks. But I did, because she was too hot. I was like, I just want like a pig tonight. Isn't that sad
something
about me?
Well, because you probably had to operate at the top of your game all the time because you
get
felt
lazy.
Like you were out of your
got
league.
A little lazy.
No.
As opposed to some party
no,
pig where you can be yourself.
She was great, because you know what she would do? She'd put a vibrator on herself and blow me.
Hey.
And that was and that made her happy. It was so easy. I didn't have to move my hips.
That's beautiful.
That's
Dom loves to be quiet and just stay still.
Really?
No need for any grunting. No, I don't need to sweat
off
any calories.
I don't mean to trouble you.
I don't want to upset my stomach before dinner.
I just like, when I'm getting blown, I just like to strike a pose and stay like that.
I'm going
to
do the podcast later. I don't want to get messy.
Hey, are we doing a show tonight? Are we doing stand-up?
Yeah. It's the main room here at the Ice House. Is it started yet?
Yeah, I think they're starting it right now.
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
Greg's doing it?
Everybody's doing it.
Oh, cool.
All these people.
Yeah, it's going to be, usually what I like to do is, if something funny happens in here, I try to go on stage and make it a bit.
Why not?
You know, like,
if you can grab something that you said and just turn it, you never know. That's the beautiful thing about doing podcasts. Yeah, every 3 or 4 podcasts, you'll get a gem.
Yeah.
You know, just pop into your head. A lot of times I forget to write it down.
I think I'm going to take off now that I got my $40 and drink tickets.
Yeah, you're going to pull a Vinny Favorito?
Yeah. Did we talk about that on the air or off the air?
Off the air, I'm pretty sure.
I can't
sure.
remember yeah. where the podcast started.
Vinny could be a little slippery. I like him.
He's very good at working the crowd, I'll tell you
oh,
that.
Oh, he's great.
He's very
great.
Good at working
he's
the crowd.
He's a good pool player. He's a pretty good pool player.
I've never
really
seen him, but I heard he's very good.
Greg can play.
He hustled me once.
Greg and I play.
Yeah.
Yeah, we played way back in the day.
I only played
when
with
we
him.
Was kids.
We just played 3 weeks
ago. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we played a few times.
But Vinny hustled me.
Oh.
Yeah,
he tried to hustle me once at the improv.
He did?
You did.
In
oh
pool?
Shit!
Yeah.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that.
The improv used to have a pool table.
Yeah, upstairs.
Oh,
yeah.
That's right. They had a little coin-operated little bar table, right?
Because what else is a comedy club need?
Why
but
did they
a
get rid of
table?
That? Why don't they
I don't
put
know.
That back
it was so
up
so much fun.
Why don't
and
we
nothing
get
goes
one?
On up there.
Let's no. get another one.
It's empty space.
What are we doing?
But Vinny played that. He did that shit to me where you go, all right, we'll play 8-ball, but I'll give you the advantage of after the break. I'll take 5 of your balls off the table, and then he'd take or 3, and he'd take the 3 that were in the way of his running the table.
Right, right.
And it was by the time he was doing it, I was like, oh,
it's a scam. It's a hustle.
Yeah,
yeah. It's a hustle.
That's the hard thing about 8-ball is balls blocking.
Well, yeah. With 8-ball, you got to know if you're going to get out, and if you're not going to get out, you got to know when you're going to play safe, and you got to be able to look at that in advance. And that's what people don't like to do. They like to just shoot and then hope they got a good shot on the next shot. But you can't do that. You got to really monitor what angle, the right angle to get the angle. That's what pool's all about. It's all about the angle to get the angle.
A pro once told me, if somebody's better than you, play them in 8-ball. If you're better than them, play them in 9-ball or straight pool. Mm. Especially straight pool.
Yeah.
Straight pool, you can't hide.
Yeah, you can't
hide. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and the only real thinking shot in that is the last shot setting up for the break. That's a tricky leave. You got to leave yourself an angle to break them up off the other ball, and where you can get power behind it without making the ball pop
out.
Dude,
my friend Justin runs the Action Report. It's Action Report. Did you ever meet him? Big giant dude, about 7 feet tall.
No,
huge dude.
Remember that.
He's a great guy. He runs this website where he puts on all these really high level pool matches between the best guys in the world. And he pays them, you know, he has like, it's basically like a two-man tournament. He has a first place prize and a second place prize put up by sponsors and shit like that. And then he sells it on pay-per-view. And you get to watch these guys. And you got
to
come with me one of these
times. I'd love to.
We watch this guy, Ari. You watch that guy, Shane Van Boning. We watched him run like seven racks in a row.
Oh, my God.
Playing 10 ball on a super tight table. I mean, this table's a brutal table, and he's just perfect on one. He got into a groove somewhere in the middle of the match. I forget who he was playing, too, because he's played a bunch of these. But when he's in the middle of this groove, all of a sudden he just locks in and just is not missing. And I was like...
Which one's Shane? The deaf
the
one?
The deaf dude, yeah. He turns his hearing aid off, and he goes into his own little world. He doesn't hear shit. Mm. And when he turns his hearing aid off, I mean, the dude is... It's incredible to watch. So you watch it, and you sit there, and you go, how the fuck is he controlling that ball like that? It's ridiculous.
It's so hard, it looks easy. It looks like, wow, yeah. I love when they diagram what the guy's going to do, and they do exactly what they say.
Yeah, yeah.
Shane is, like, perfect on every shot. It's ridiculous to watch, because you know how hard that is to do. To get perfect on one shot, you're like, whoa, look at that, nice. You know, you're laughing with your friends. He's perfect on every shot. Perfect, perfect, perfect. He's controlling the revolutions of a ball as it collides into another ball with a stick. And he's controlling it to within one or two rolls.
What's the problem? Casual fans can't figure that out?
Nobody can figure that out.
Oh, I don't know if that's good or bad.
It's really something that it's an art form that you have to do to be able to appreciate. Like if Dom or Greg were watching Francisco Bustamante play, or one of the best players in the world, he'd be like, Jesus Christ. Like you watch him, like you can't make that shot. You know you're not gonna get that position. You know you're not gonna follow the ball like that. And you watch it and you get this feeling from it. It's like, geez, like you realize how fucking difficult it is to do what that guy's doing. But a regular person doesn't see it. A regular person just sees, that was easy. That was easy.
It's like when I watch bowling. Yeah. I'm like, you're fucking throwing a ball.
Yeah, what could be so hard? Throw it at the same spot.
What's the problem, stupid? Just practice.
I just feel like I can make any great shot. But that's all. It's one and out.
Yeah, yeah, but you've gone on runs when we play where you hit that groove for like 5, 6, 7, 8 balls in a row. It's like every now and then you hit a groove, and that's what the crazy thing about pool is. Like you start to get a memory going of how hard you have to hit that ball with that stick to get that ball to move a certain distance, and you store all that information in your muscle memory and in your patterns. So it's like a balancing act of the muscle memory of exactly how hard to stroke the ball and the patterns of how it's going to collide off the ball and interact with other balls. And it becomes this fucking mad dance for perfection that's unattainable. And every now and then you just get
Joe,
out.
Joe, the other night I couldn't end on because Joe will run fucking 9 balls, and then I got the – and then he'll miss the bank on the 10 ball.
Yeah.
Then I hit it in, and I win the game.
Yeah. That's 10 balls.
He's real susceptible to that.
That's how it goes.
I can't leave on this. I said I can't. I know. I just can't do
it. Yeah, I'll run like 8, 9 balls in a row and then fuck up position. Because my game is not that good. It's like there's a lot of holes in it, and the holes show up in 10 ball more than 9 ball. Because believe it or not, that one extra ball makes a big difference in your position. Because if I'm out of line on the 7 ball to get to the 8 ball, and then on the 9 I'm cutting it in wild, and now I'm fucked on the 10. That's like
you got to be 3 shots ahead.
Exactly. You have to be more precise than I am right now. So when I play, I fuck up a lot.
But you know what it is? It's a lot like
fun though, man.
There's a lot of sports that are stroke sports. You know, whether it's golf. Or darts, where it's like. It's that same stroke, and like
basketball.
You're saying, once you feel it, you kind of internalize it and it's unconscious. It's just you're doing it. If you're thinking about it, you're not in a groove.
I was playing my friend Tommy. We were over at my house once and I hit this groove on my home table. You know, I play on my home table all the time. I ran four racks in a row before I knew what I had done.
Wow.
I'd run one. Yeah, one was like from the it was like the three or the four ball. I ran that out. And then I basically ran three racks after that. You know, it's like, either I ran and played safe, or and then I got ball in hand or something like that. But either way, I won like a bunch of games in a row where I was on autopilot, where like everything just did what I told it to. But it didn't last. I can only do it for like 15, 20 minutes. And then I can't just keep up the concentration. I'll fuck up. I'll miss an easy shot. I'll get bad position. But for brief moments, whether it's like one, two, three games, you just hit this groove where that ball's just slap right in the back of the pocket, right in the center of the hole, and you got that ball on a string, and you're just moving it around at will.
But you have that extra battery in you. You know, like the iPhones have that pack where you could turn that extra. He has that with everything.
Yeah.
Like, you have it with your show, you have it with your stand-up, and you have it with pool. We're playing pool for like 2.5 hours. He goes, I'm just getting warmed up. I'm fucking
you're
tired.
You're begging to go home.
I'm getting tired of racking for you, Joe.
Tired of racking, and quite honestly, you're annoying me.
Well, you know what, though? I play with my friend Max Eberly, and I just get tortured. Max Eberly is one of the best in the world, and he just puts beatings on me. You get so broken down that you're scared to shoot when you finally do get a shot.
Yeah,
because he can just get out. He gets out from everywhere. Max is one of the best players on earth.
Yeah.
I mean, he really is like top 10 on the planet.
Really?
So, oh yeah, no doubt about it. I've seen Max Eberly run 100 ball straight pool more than once. I've seen him run 5-6 racks in a row of 10 ball, just practicing and fucking around. He's like a perfect, he's got perfect mechanics.
Yeah, well, perfect mechanics and probably something a little off, like ADHD.
A little bit of that, looking for chemtrails.
Yep.
UFOs are coming. Looking
he's like semi-autistic.
Running out like a motherfucker. Yeah, he's a great guy, though. And he's a great instructor, too. He helped me a lot.
You helped me.
Well, I just told you what he told me. And Aubrey started taking lessons with him, too. You know, you guys did a little bit together, right? But then Aubrey went back and took like a two-hour lesson with him.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Max Eberly, like, he's like super technical. Like, he'll break everything down. If you ever wanted to do it, it'd be really fun. It would change your game.
Yeah.
Like, right away, your game would get like one or two balls better. It's really amazing. Because sometimes you don't realize you just like have a little hitch here or there where you're kind of doing something weird. It's like, that's why pool is sort of like almost like a yoga thing. It's like you have to have complete control of your mind and your body.
Well, he had that. He had that book, Zen Pool.
Zen Pool, that's what his whole book is about, trying to get to that state where you just zone out and get everything lined up so that all your technical aspects are perfect, and then get into the groove.
You get your mind to a certain thing, like with stand-up. I could never be as conscious as I am in regular life as I am in stand-up. Don't you get that when you go on stage? I mean, you're kind of elevated. You're brighter. You're quicker. I mean, when I walk around half the time in the daytime, I'm like this dolt.
Yeah.
I don't even know why I walked into a room.
Yeah, I have conversations.
I get lost every fucking day driving. Every day I get lost somewhere. Because I'm not thinking about it.
When
I'm on stage, there's a bunch of people. Yeah. There's fear. And there's excitement and there's creativity, and I'm in it 100%. And what's sad is when I'm on the road, I get so depressed because I'm away from my kids. And if I'm not on stage, then all I'm thinking about is I'm going on stage.
Yeah.
And it's perfect when you're up there, and then everything crashes down. They all leave the room.
I very rarely am on the road by myself. I always bring like all my friends. Like I bring Ari or Joey or Duncan or whoever. But when I am, if I do find myself on the road, I treat it like I'm at work camp. That's what I treat it like. I bring the laptop and I just said, all right, you got no excuse. Get that laptop out of here.
Fire bad.
I sit in front of that thing and I said, look, you got no excuse. You got 8 hours where you don't have to do
nothing. There's nothing to do.
Yeah,
there's nothing going on.
Go to work, bitch.
Yeah.
Go to work. Start writing.
Well, that's you were huge. Talking to me.
No, that's me. Talking to myself.
What happened to
Joe? Call myself, bitch.
I'm going to go check on the show.
Show just started. We got Tony's on stage and Iko's the first one up, then me.
You're on second to last, so.
Oh, am I?
And then who's after you?
Here, I'll tell you the lineup real quick.
So we don't have to worry for like 15, 20 minutes?
Oh, you have a while.
Okay.
I think the end of the show
started.
Dom, and you. So we've got about four acts before that.
It goes Ari after me, Greg, Dom, Joe.
Powerful.
And Ryan Mervin forgot to come.
How dare
Mervis.
He?
Mervis. He actually was drunk when I invited him, and he doesn't remember it. He was in a black.
He gets like, he's so big, he gets this other level of drunk.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
And suddenly he's like touching and like holding you hard.
Hey, man.
And you're like, oh my God, he's like a bear.
My friend Justin does that too.
Mervis.
Have you ever been drunk with Justin from the Action Report, that Justin?
No, he gets like that.
Yeah, he gets crazy.
They store up the liquor.
He's a gorilla, man. The dude's 7 feet tall, and I'm not even joking. He's probably 7 feet tall. He's at least like 6'5". I don't know what the fuck he is. He's a giant.
He's 6'7", 6'8".
He's big. He's giant.
Fat.
He's a giant dude. Yeah, he's like someone in a movie. What is that? Hey, you already drink out of that? Did you already drink out of that, bitch?
Not this right here.
Yeah, get the fuck out of here. That's kind of delicious.
Being around guys that big is so, because I'm small. Like I just had Joey Diaz on my podcast a couple days ago. And it's like, I know he's a nice guy, but I'm always afraid, like, somebody so big like that, like, he's going to kill me. And I know there's nothing in that in his heart, but, like, it's like being near a Mack truck when you're on the sidewalk. You start thinking something horrible.
Yeah.
Joey's a big guy. You know, he's not just fat. He's a big fucking dude. He's always been a big dude. When I met Joey, I have a picture of him on my wall in my office from his earliest headset. I stole it from the Comedy Store. And he looks like he's a football player. He looks like he's, like, 205 pounds, 220 maybe, a football player. Solid as a rock.
Yeah.
Joey's he was a big guy before he was a fat guy. He's solid.
I used to think of that with Vinny Curto.
Oh, remember yeah. Mm-hmm.
He
yeah.
was such a fucking strong dude.
He scared me.
That you think, now I understand prison rape in the sense that, really, if Vinny wanted to rape you.
You'd have some problems with that.
You know.
All you could hope is, I hope it's date rape so I get a meal out of it.
Yeah.
And not the regular
dinner
rape.
And a movie.
I wonder if that, to be on the receiving end of that, like, would it be worse to be raped by a total stranger as a dude, or by somebody that you knew?
Wait, if it was in prison, we're assuming
it's just
making you go on a date with them.
Talk
raped.
About a no-win question.
Yeah.
Would you rather get hit in the face with a bag of shit?
Are we really?
It seems like the date rape would be better, right?
Bringing ourselves down to what-ifing this shit.
Yeah.
How dare you?
At least the other guy leaves.
Drag us into this.
I always think of that with gay guys. Like, what's the first sentence after they have anal sex?
What is the first sentence?
Put ESPN on, will you? Like, I mean, what is the first thing that comes out?
Well, that was awesome. I love that. Probably something along those lines.
Or we should go, somebody's waiting to use the stall.
Yeah, something along those lines.
Somebody with a wide stance.
Do you have any more meth, yes or no?
I'd hope they'd clean off. That's what I would do.
I was in
maybe in like the sink?
Clean off.
What do they do?
Clean off would be a good move. It's all poopy.
Mm.
We were in Santa Monica Boulevard, and there's a giant billboard that says, are you having like a problem with meth? And there's a guy, and there's like, you know, like he's got like a face, like his life is falling apart. Yeah. Like, how much meth are people doing? They have to have a meth billboard in Santa Monica Boulevard?
Ooh. Yeah.
Is that a big problem in the gay community? Is that what it is?
Yeah. Meth?
Is that what it is?
Yeah. They used to do like...
It's like Bakersfield.
They used to do that.
That too. I think it's everywhere.
Glycerin, right?
Yeah.
Email nitrate.
Yeah. Email nitrate.
Yeah, they apparently do poppers when they would have anal sex. It, like, loosens up your butthole.
It's called anal nitrates?
No, amyl. Can you imagine?
Wait a minute. Anal nitrates.
Hold the fuck on.
Are you the straight man in this?
I always thought it was anal nitrates.
You know, that's the thing that guy Peter Duesberg, he's that biologist from the University of California, Berkeley, that doesn't believe that HIV causes AIDS. It's a very controversial guy. Yeah, put it mildly, right? He believes that HIV is a weak virus, and that HIV is only found in the immune systems of people who already are depleted. And it's not the symptom of what's making them sick. It's just it's one of the things that shows that they are sick. It's not the cause, rather. And he says that it's drug use, and that in the gay community they didn't factor in the massive use of different immune system destroying drugs like amyl nitrate. That's a big one. Apparently, that stuff just gives you fucking brain damage.
What's
like,
the
right
high?
Away.
What's the high?
I don't know. Apparently, it's awesome. It's awesome if a dude's fucking your butt.
Oh.
And it's super intense. And crystal meth apparently is another one. But he said these are all like this partying and not getting enough sleep and taking all these amphetamines. That crushes your immune system. And he's saying that these people are showing up with HIV because they can catch anything. They would have the flu, they have a cold. Right. It's not HIV that's causing this. He's saying that it's being caused by illegal drugs. Now, I don't know. I'm too stupid to understand whether he's right or he's wrong, but yeah. I think it's amazing when a guy is like a biologist at a university.
That he would say that.
Yeah, that he would say even say something like that. Apparently, there's a lot of people that disagree with him, and I'm absolutely not saying that I know who's right.
Go ahead.
The whole Christian Coalition movement is that that's the, one of their mantras is HIV does not cause AIDS.
Well, it doesn't seem to me like that's something that would you'd be able to hide. It seems to me like if that was actually the truth, that, that there's no way legitimate scientists would be willing to just not be honest about their research. That at a certain point in time, someone would have to understand. This, they would have to look at it and say, well, that's not what's causing this. I think we're incorrect. I think this. It seems like other people would find that. There's
they have to rethink a given, though. It's like it's a given that it causes AIDS.
Is it a given?
And then they have to, like, get that out of their minds.
I don't. You know what? I really don't understand how they conduct experiments. So I'm just completely talking out of my ass. But I just assume that something like that would be really hard to hide.
I heard this study. You know? They said that even when papers are overturned, like let's say Einstein's theory of relativity was like proven false.
Right.
Was it?
No, it wasn't. Oh. No.
But like whatever it is, people will still quote the original, even though they've seen that it's overturned.
Yeah.
People will still continue to quote the original, like professors, just because they don't know.
Well, people how to do in it. School Doctors. Will teach that you only use 10% of your brain. I mean, they will still say that. I mean, I've heard kids tell me that their fucking teacher told that.
So are you saying that creationism is no longer valid?
No.
Because it seems to be cited a lot. By, I don't know, 60% of the country still doesn't believe in evolution.
60%?
I'm sorry. Of the Christian, I've just read all this shit about the Christians. 60% of them don't believe
it's amazing
in
what they believe.
Yeah.
Well, it's more than 50%.
They believe the Earth is only 10,000 years old.
Yeah, that's a big number of people believe that. They said there's millions of people that believe the Earth is less than 10,000 years old.
That's hilarious.
And again, in the face of quantifiable carbon dating, you know, there's no...
Doesn't matter.
It's not a theory. Yeah.
People believe what they want to believe.
Yeah.
It's like... I love when, like, sports fans, you go, I think he sucks. The guy hit 350.
There's statistics that show it.
I still think he sucks.
So many negative people. So how the fuck are you winning that? I've had people say, I'll fucking kick that guy's ass, tell you like that. I go, dude, you don't even know what you're talking about. That guy could do anything he wants to you.
When I went to the Tyson Spinks fight, I told you about that, right? I was sitting up front.
You went to Tyson Spinks?
Tyson. Michael Spinks.
Yeah.
And it was like up jumped the devil. I mean, he was so fucking scary looking.
Oh yeah.
And
how close were you?
I was like second row.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
That was the first fight I ever remember.
Yeah. Like
how much was talked about?
It 70 seconds or something. And this is an example of that. This guy Gene went to the bathroom. Of course, he missed the fight.
Oh my god.
And he says, "Fuck, I could have lasted longer than that." I go, "But Gene,
no,
he wouldn't last. Nobody would pay $1,200 to see Gene
you run
fight
away.
Tyson.
Run away for more than 12 seconds.
You wouldn't though. You don't understand. You don't understand. You don't understand how easy it would be for him to close the distance.
He would kill you.
He would hit you with one punch. It'd be over. You'd
be
done.
Would he know there's a
seconds.
Limit that he has to beat? Does he know about the 12 seconds?
Well, it doesn't matter.
What if
you don't offer a threat. This guy, he's doing that to Michael Spinks, and Michael Spinks offers a legitimate threat. He was a world champion. He was a world champion at light heavyweight and at heavyweight. He beat Larry Holmes. Michael Spinks was a real threat, and he didn't give a fuck. He ran through him.
He just ran through him.
What he would do to you would be horrific.
Well, he'd be horrific.
He wouldn't worry about you. You'd feel so helpless.
Well, also, his neck was able to take in that one punch. Your head might literally just collapse.
Yeah, you're fucking face might cave in. Bill Burr called me up before this. He said he was having a conversation with his father. His father is something to do with fixing people's. He was in Nam and fixed people's faces after they got shot and blown up and shit. So he's watching mixed martial arts, and he goes, "I don't fucking understand it." And Bill says, "Well, you know, it's an art. You know, the fighting is." He goes, "You know, it's an art." He goes, "It's an art is that your cranial facial cavity and your brain, your skull are all connected in this whole intricate thing, and they're all connected. It's all together in one big thing, and that's how you think. That's a fucking art, not flattening your fucking face out with an elbow." And I'm like, "Well, he's got a point." I mean, I still like watching it. It's my favorite thing to watch, but he's got a point. I mean, you know, those guys know what the fuck's going on. They know what kind of crazy risks they're taking when they do that. A lot of them get broken bones in their face.
I think about it. I'm super like, common. This is like super dangerous for all of them.
So easy to break your face.
You shouldn't be watching this, but it is fun to watch.
Breaking your face is real easy, especially your nose. Nose breaks so easy.
How about that body shot the other night, the way the guy went down on that?
Which one? Which fight?
Fuck, I think it was like the second.
Dong Young Kim?
The one before the final fight.
Was it Damian Maia and Dong Young Kim? That wasn't really a body shot. He took him down, and then taking him down, his ribs crapped out.
Yeah, that one. That was a really unlucky fall.
That guy's an assassin, man.
Yeah.
That Damian Maia guy, he's a super high-level jiu-jitsu guy. Like, the kind of guy you're terrified to roll with. Yeah. He's super technical, multiple-time world champion, taps out black belts on a regular basis. Like, that guy rolls with, like, really legit UFC fighters and just manhandles them. Triangle, arm bar, gets your back, chokes you, does whatever the fuck you want to. That guy had Frank Mir, and he fights at 170 now. Frank Mir is former heavyweight champion. Frank Mir rolled with him, and he goes, I'm really a brown belt. He goes, I'm not really a black belt. He goes, and Frank Mir is fucking incredible. Incredible. The arm bar he broke Tim Sylvia's forearm with, I've never seen anybody execute an arm bar like that before. Broke a guy's forearm, man. That's a weird place to break it. Somebody's usually you're getting the, you're getting like the elbow. The elbow snaps. He's got so much power. He's snapping the fucking forearm. And he broke Nogueira's shoulders. Like, his submissions are destruction. So for that guy to say that he's really a brown belt after he rolls with Damian Maia, who's now fighting at 170, that's how scary this guy is.
Terrifying is when he's got you in one of those holes from behind because you can't tap out because your arms are fucking completely...
Well, you know what's scary?
It's the worst.
What's scary is a guy like me who's been doing jiu-jitsu since like 1996, and I still can get bitched and manhandled by like a really good guy. I just get tapped out like all over the place. There's nothing I could do about it.
Have you ever been in a position where you couldn't tap out?
No. You know, you can verbally tap.
They had those. I remember those.
You can verbally tap, too. You say tap, tap, tap. But people know. Like, anybody who's good enough to tap you knows when you can't tap. You know what I mean? Like, if I've got a guy's arms wrapped up, I know when he can't. You know, if he's flattened out on his stomach, you know when he can't tap. You know when his arms are tied up. But there's not a whole lot of positions where you can't tap with at least one hand. Or your foot. You could tap with your foot.
Yeah.
You know? But tap. Say tap, tap, tap. The best is just to say it.
Yeah.
Is there any comedian? It's
very important to tap, man.
Joe, is there any comedian that you think you can't beat?
I don't know.
Russell Peters.
That's my boy. I would let him win because I love him.
Russell Peters.
I love that guy. Russell Peters gave me this watch. Look at this watch.
He's so fucking
generous. It's a Breitling. It's a beautiful watch. Yeah. I just complimented him. We were in Vegas, and he came to the fights, and I go, hey, man, nice watch. He goes, put it on.
And I go,
I'm not wearing that fucking watch. Put the fucking watch on. And he like shoves it over my hand. I go, all right, dude, well, you got to take my watch then. So I gave him my watch. But my watch
is considerably
cheaper than his watch. This is like a really nice watch. My watch is a really nice watch. My watch was a TW Steel, which is like an inexpensive watch, but it's a nice watch. It's like a clean, I like mechanical looking watches, you know?
Yeah.
Not too big. No watch at all, Greg Fitzsimmons? Not even a digital?
I can't. Time fucks with me too much.
Really?
So, yeah, I can't think about it. Yeah, I have ADD, and I have my iPhone, and I set every fucking event in my day beeps an hour before and 15 minutes before, and that's my clock.
Really?
I can't, yeah.
That's how you do it all the time?
Yep. I obsessively program my phone because I'm lost. I get fucking lost.
Are you still worried that you forgot to program it?
Yes.
Okay. Mm. Yep. So you have to keep looking over
it. Yeah, it's really, my mind is not, I wouldn't invite you in there. It's not pleasant.
Well, that's the only way to be funny. Do you know any funny person who's completely got their fucking brain in order?
No.
Jesus, I can't think of any.
I was talking to John.
There's creepy shit in every single one of us. Every single one of us has something creepy going on in the background.
I was talking to John Katz. You know,
I love John.
He says to me, he goes, you ever take a shit and it smells so bad you start crying? I go, John, I cry every time I shit. He goes, you're trying to think of fucking ridiculous things when you were talking about those questions. It's like,
yeah.
Jonathan Katz was the host the first time I went on stage.
Was he really?
Wow.
Yeah.
He wasn't much of a host. Stitches. He was more of a
middle act.
Middle act, a great middle act.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was the days of Teddy Bergeron and his greatness.
Oh, and his crying drunkenness?
Well, no. Right? This is before Teddy Bergeron fell apart. Those
he
days.
Cried and got he was drunk good, right?
Yeah. Oh, he was so good. Teddy Bergeron was amazing.
Well, his performing skills were about as good as any comic I've ever seen
ever,
in my life.
Ever. Ever.
I mean, he could act out a scene in, like, with
Gladiator
Shakespearean
scenes.
Precision.
Yeah. Wow. He was a brilliant writer.
By the time I saw him, he was drinking too much.
Yeah.
Wasn't, I think it was pills. There was a lot. Yeah, there was a lot of different air, but it was for sheer stand-up comedy. I mean,
what about
that
the bit
guy.
Where he's talking about he was making fun of guys at AA meetings in Boston and how they're so like. He goes, I like to stand in the back of the room and fuck with them when they're up at the podium qualifying. He goes, I got a can of soda in my hand, and the guys up front going, and I'm proud to say, after 14 years, I no longer crave a drink. Where is it?
He had some great fucking bits, man. He had some great bits.
I heard one time he broke out in tears on stage, and he was crying, and he went and sat on the edge of the stage, and he was just sobbing. Really? And the audience was howling, laughing, thinking that it was an act.
Oh, wow.
They thought he was fucking brilliant.
Dude, I got to see him when he was completely out of it. I don't know what he's doing these days. I hope he's back in order, but I got to see him. I did a show with him at the Mattapoisett Inn.
Oh.
And he was completely out of it, man. Yeah. And this is long after he'd done The Tonight Show, and Johnny Carson brought him over to the couch. I mean, he was...
But do you know why Johnny Carson brought him over to the couch?
Why?
Because he did so much time that he bumped the other guest. So he didn't bring him over to the couch.
No
because
way.
That's what the real story is. Yeah, he did like 9 minutes. He was supposed to do 6 minutes. So he did so much overtime that they had to bring
extended
him.
A little more to make up for the
it
other.
It was so good. It might be one of the best Tonight Show sets I've ever
really?
Seen.
Really?
Teddy Bergeron?
It might be the best Tonight Show set I've ever seen. I wonder if somebody has it online.
Teddy Bergeron?
Yes. And if you look at it in the context of the time, you know, what is it, like 84, 85 that he got on Tonight Show, something like that? Man,
he was so pompous when he got. He's a pompous dude, and so he got the Tonight Show, and apparently everybody was just like, "All right, Teddy, shut the fuck up." So he goes into the Tonight Show, comes back to Nick's, falls down drunk, laying in his own piss on the steps at Nick's Comedy Stop, and the famous line, you know this. Yeah. Somebody stepped over him like Sweeney, and goes, "Teddy Bergeron, didn't I see you on the Tonight Show?" And then just kept walking. Oh.
There was a lot of cruelty in those Boston towns.
Yeah. He showed up. We were doing a gig together, and he was the headliner, and I was the feature act, so I stretched Friday night until he got there. And he tells the club owner, takes him out to the parking lot, he goes, look at my side view mirror. Some fucking asshole sideswiped me at 93 North. So anyway, sorry I'm late. Next night, shows up late. I'm stretching. Tries to tell the club owner the same fucking story, forgetting he'd said it the night before.
Every night somebody does this.
My God.
I love drama queens like that.
Some people are just never on time, man. They never can get to a gig on time. They just can't get it together. You know? It's almost like they want to be late. They fucking delay leaving. They fuck around. They take a longer shit than they should. They jerk off. I'm going to fucking look at their email. I should leave.
Like, oh, fuck, fuck.
Fuck, I got to leave.
Yeah, and then you're driving. That's my story. And I get to every audition out of breath. My fucking pulse is racing. And then I'm trying to read sides, and I suck.
I hate that shit. Anybody want a drink? I'm going to go get a drink.
Sure. Yeah. Whatever you're going to have.
I'm going to have a martini.
I'll do it. I'm not scared.
I'm all right. Thanks.
Dom Herrera.
Hey, can I plug
keep
my
it together.
Factory date?
You can do whatever the fuck you want. You're Dom Herrera.
July 27th at the Laugh Factory in Long Beach.
Oh, the Long Beach one. I heard that's a nice place.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
I went down to the aquarium there the other day. It's a good aquarium down there.
I haven't been there, but I like that area.
It's one of the best aquariums in the country.
Yeah,
it's great.
Nice. Nice aquarium. Holla.
Just a martini?
Give me, I don't know. Whatever you're having, brother. All
right.
When's this podcast go up?
Well, it's on Ustream tonight, and then Brian will get about uploading it. He's got a few to catch up on his network. Could be a couple of years.
So let's talk about like extraterrestrial
shit. Well, I already fucked up with the Spider-Man spoilers. I really did not do that on purpose.
You just
folks.
Yelled
I
out the beginnings of it, asshole. The ends of it?
I just rolled out key plot points. I made a few fake
you
got to
give people
up,
at least 4 weeks.
I made a few fake ones up about him fucking his
to
sister
cover it up.
And some other shit.
He said that Spider-Man was jerking off and he couldn't come, so he shot some.
I would love if they had a superhero movie and showed actual fucking. Yeah. Like when during the love scene, then it just continued and they had penetration. And then right
well,
back
well, they
to
did
the
a
plot.
Movie where with Vincent Gallo and
Brown Bunny?
Yeah.
And Chloe's Venier.
Chloe's Venier.
With an actual
She sucked
his
dick.
He wrote that into the script.
Of course he did.
He was the director.
He wrote it in Chloe 7 and he gives me a blowjob.
Yep, and he came on her face. It wasn't even, she swallowed. It wasn't even like romantic.
And it was long and it was not pleasant. It was like they were down and out kind of fucked up people.
To you, it wasn't pleasant. To me is what I needed to know that day. It's so ridiculous. It's so funny that you can fake fucking, but if you really fuck, people go crazy. He's really fucking. This is insane. It's weird, man. It's really weird. That is exclusive. They are mutually exclusive. You cannot have the two of them together. You can either have a movie where you have fucking, or you can movie where you have fake fucking and a lot of other stuff. You could have violence and UFOs, and you can have anything else you want, as long as you have fake fucking.
Yeah,
but real fucking.
As soon as you have real fucking in it, we're not interested.
Yeah, meanwhile, with real fucking, you actually can't see the parts as much because they're stuffed inside of each other. With fake fucking, it's like, you know, there's dicks flopping around and split wet beavers.
Could you imagine if that became what they had to do? What if, like, actresses and actors had to really fuck in movies? Like, people demanded that they really fuck. Eventually, look, no one was doing it the way back in the Gone with the Wind days, there was no sexual content the way we have now. It was like, if a man smacked a woman in the face, it was like foreplay. It was like craziness. He grabs her and, like, whoa, they're getting out of hand.
He's raping her.
There was no a guy going down on her and the girl's tits are out. And I mean, that is in movies today where it's fake. But he's eating her pussy.
Sure.
Yeah.
Her feet are on his shoulders. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're fucking. They're looking at each other. They're sweating. You see naked bodies and legs. How come they can't really fuck? They can't really. If you really.
It should be allowed to.
Really fuck. Yeah, you can do everything else. You can make out.
An audience can't handle that back and forth. Like, if I see people fucking on screen, I'm going to want to jerk off. I can't all of a sudden get invested in a narrative.
I used to get hard just during make-out scenes, just during sex scenes.
You but why don't you little. Get why don't you get hard when they're fake fucking?
No, you do. A good sex scene in a movie?
It's actually better. I get more turned on by
fake
a
scene?
Great Gina, what's her name? She did Gershon? That lesbians Gina Gershon.
Davis. Oh yeah.
Bound. I mean, no porn has ever matched that for getting me where I wanted to be.
She's the kind of girl that after you come, you think maybe I should kill her. This bitch might be a problem.
That's the plot of most of her movies.
Like, right. She as soon as you killed. Come, she's looking at you. Her mascara's running. She's growling. You're like, oh, God. Fuck, this is going to be a problem. This crazy bitch is going to kill me. I got to kill her first.
Yeah, there's a bunch of actresses that are like that.
She still maintains hotness deep into her 40s, too.
Yeah.
She's in her 40s still, and you still see pictures of her like, oh, that. She still wants it. Still
you know
wants
who's
it.
Married
still going
to her
to the gym.
Is Sam Simon.
Sam
he used
Simon.
To be married to her. The guy who created the Simpsons.
Really? I didn't know who else. That's interesting.
He's a fucking billionaire.
Is he? Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah, Simpsons? He's got a lot of dough.
What a gold mine. You want to talk about a show that went forever? That's insane. I was in high school. I was in high school and the Simpsons were on, and they're still on.
Yeah.
They're still on TV.
And the merchandising that goes with it, that alone would make you a billionaire.
That's insane.
Yeah.
I love the fact that there's people out there that are just so prolific like that.
Yeah.
Whether it's South Park is the
craziest one. Not Sam Simon. He created the show with them, was on it for a few years, gone, gets 1/3 of the royalties for life.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, that's the gig.
Oh.
That's not a gig.
That's chilling. Beautiful.
Yeah.
That guy must just have busloads of Thai hookers just show up on his front door.
You know what he does?
What kind of money
rescues
does he
dogs.
Have? Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah. Spends most of his money doing animal shit.
Oh, that's nice. I love that. Because I could see the horror route, too. I could see him just going full hooker.
Well, he does it for the hookers.
Vegas,
maybe it's hookers and dogs.
Yeah.
Hookers and puppies. Exclusive. It's like he rewards himself for his good deeds with some sex slavery.
Yeah. You're a whore? Do you have a dog?
Let's help you both out.
Yeah, you should have him on the show. He's an interesting guy.
Yeah?
Yeah, he's been on my show a few times.
Really? Has he? No shit.
He's great.
So he invented it? Did he invent it?
I think he was a big show runner at the time because it's Groening, Sam Simon, and the director who directs every fucking sitcom.
Jim Burrows?
Yeah.
Jim Burrows directed The Simpsons?
No, James L. Brooks.
Oh, James Brooks. Okay.
The three of them together created it, and I think Sam Simon was the respected showrunner at that time, so he was the one that took a cartoon strip, which was Groening's, turned it into a show that Brooks directed, so he always had the clout where if he directs a pilot, here's the beautiful thing about Hollywood also, is if you direct a pilot for a TV show and you never work on it a second after that, you get a piece of that show for life.
God damn. That's amazing.
Yeah.
You know what? I knew that and I forgot it. That's amazing. Yeah. If you direct the pilot, you get a chunk. Well, that's James Burrows. You know?
Yep.
Jim Burrows, the guy from Taxi.
Taxi.
He did, he did Taxi. He did Cheers.
Oh God, Brian, you gotta IMDb that his fucking list of. Oh, you're not Brian.
It's Pete. No. Yeah, he did News Radio. I don't know if he did the pilot because I wasn't in the pilot. I was in the first episode.
And he'll direct 3 pilots a season.
Yep, and everybody wants him because first of all, he knows how to fucking do it. The guy's a real pro. Like we would slice through scenes. He'd be like, "This doesn't work. Wait, hold on, come in through here. You from here, and you seeing him." Whoa, what's he doing there?
Yeah.
Okay, go, shoot.
And he would
he would just figure the scene out and like fix it. He was like just like a super old pro. He was an awesome guy too.
And for all the work that goes into that scene that's being shot, he's the gatekeeper. Yeah. Yeah, he's the last guy that can catch mistakes and fix things.
Well, he was beautiful too because he's like super demanding and you know, he's like and when we first started doing News Radio, Paul Sims and those guys, the guys that did News Radio were really crazy. They would start writing at like 4 o'clock in the morning and like have like 1/3 of the script done while the table read starts. So we would like read like 1/3 and then we'd go to work on that 1/3. And then like a couple hours later, one of them would stumble in barefoot. It was usually this guy, Josh Lee, and he would have like the rest of the script. They had just banged it out in a couple of hours. And it was usually great, man. It was like, but you know, Burroughs wouldn't let him get away with it. He would get on him for that kind of shit.
I remember Paul Sims always wearing a hooded sweatshirt with the hood up.
he's a real, you know, there's a lot of dudes that like fake that genius artist sort of thing. He's the real deal. Yeah. He's a real genius and a fascinating guy.
Well, he did a great fucking sitcom before that. Was it Larry David's first?
Yeah, the Larry Sanders Show.
Yeah.
Larry Sanders Show.
Yeah.
Yeah, he did that. He went from that to News Radio.
And now he writes in The New Yorker. He's got a column.
Does he?
Like most weeks.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I know I think he did something for Boardwalk Empire, too. I haven't talked to him in a million years.
Fuck, that's a good show, man.
Is it?
Oh,
I haven't watched it once.
It wasn't at first. It's like a lot of those shows that they figure it out in the second season.
But can't invest in another goddamn show.
No, I know.
Can't do it.
What are your shows that
Game
like.
Game of Thrones is my number one.
That's it.
Man. Oh, I love it. I like bullshit. Okay, I don't want to deal with like, you know, real life marriage problems or, you know, fucking real life crime and violence. I don't care about that.
Yeah.
I can see that on the news. Mm-hmm. I want to see swords. Nobody fights with swords anymore. I want to see dragons. I want to see the fucking Game of Thrones. It was like it was made for me. I'm a fucking 44-year-old child.
And there's some good nude scenes, right?
Fucking awesome. They go to whorehouses all day. They're constantly getting hookers. Because that's how they lived back then. If you were running around every day not knowing whether you're going to die of the plague or get your leg chopped off by a fucking sword, you got hookers every chance you could.
Yeah.
And that's how they do it. Every time they go to their brothels, and there's dragons, and there's fucking zombies, and there's awesome sword fights. It's like it's the perfect fucking show. It's a beautiful creation.
I've been saving it because everybody says that. I like to watch whole seasons of good shows.
You should watch the first two seasons.
It's the third season
now? The third season won't start until April. So if you start now and give yourself like a good pacing, by the time the third season rolls around, you'll have caught up on all the episodes and you will be fucking famished. Mm-hmm. You'll be dying for a Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
It's fucking great. It's the greatest show. I mean, for me, obviously. You know, some people claim The Wire. I didn't get into The Wire. I only watched a couple of episodes and I dropped it, but... Everybody says it's the greatest show ever.
Breaking Bad might be top two or three of all time.
Amazing. And I'm behind. I only watched the first season. I need to jump back
in. Oh, so you didn't see the part where...
Jesus!
Catch up.
I know. I need to. But I don't have that much time. And I got on this Game of Thrones thing. I was just at Barnes & Noble. And, you know, I'll just wander through, like, the DVD section. Just seeing if something catches my eye. And I'm like, Game of Thrones. Right? How bad does this fucking show suck? Look at it. All these stars. Great reviews on it. Okay, whatever. I knew nothing. I literally knew nothing about the plot. Nothing about the... And I watched... From episode one on, I am hooked. I'm like, this is the greatest show ever.
Isn't it great when you go into something with no preconceptions?
Oh, it's
you
beautiful.
Haven't seen a trailer for it, and it's just...
I didn't know who the actors were. I didn't know. I mean, I recognized a few people from different things, but I didn't know who was going to be in what. I didn't know anything about the plot line. I didn't know nothing. It was awesome.
Yeah. It's so amazing, good. Too, because working in TV, and you're so consistently disappointed by what you're making or a part of, and then you see something that's done that well, and you went... oh yeah, that's a possibility too.
HBO is the best at putting together those series. No one can fuck with them. If you think about it, Sopranos, The Wire, Boardwalk Empire, the like the really badass dramatic series, nobody can fuck with them. And the Game of Thrones, Sopranos and Game of Thrones, come on, really? In the same network produces Sopranos and the Game of Thrones?
And Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Fuck, Jesus Christ.
Yeah. You know what's fucking great? What? Veep. Did you see Veep?
No. Is it really
Holy
good?
Shit.
Is it really good?
It is as good as any new show I've seen in 10 years.
Wow.
And Julie Louise Dreyfus, who you always like acknowledge, very talented, really good, but shows a fucking dark, twisted side of herself. And it's shot really like you know, like The Office. It's shot like in that shaky camera.
Oh.
And it's just, they nail the casting, and she just is like beyond what you ever imagined. Great fucking series. Yeah, but now Showtime is putting out some good shit, and AMC with Breaking Bad, and then what's the other really good show they do? I don't know, Louis C.K.'s on FX. So it's anyone's game, you know, because people TiVo shit anyway, or they're downloading a whole series at a time. So what network something goes on is not that limited anymore. It's not like HBO and Showtime are the only ones that can do groundbreaking TV. You can curse. You can practically show full nudity on these other channels. And so it's kind of a good time to be in TV.
Yeah, it's definitely way better. But I think even what's even better now is internet TV. Like a lot of these, like I think YouTube is now doing actual shows on it, and there's Netflix has their own shows. Like getting off the networks in general, I think is the next wave. Especially since people can pretty much make their own sitcoms, you know, from YouTube and get more hits. Like look at half these YouTube stars; they're getting way more people watching them than you know, like fucking whatever. Who's the Boss 2.
Oh yeah. Yeah, and it's
on TV anymore.
Yeah, and it's an opportunity to have less cooks in the kitchen. I mean, it's like now it's time to put your money where your mouth is. Everybody complains about how TV gives you bad notes and ruins the product. Well, guess what? For a fucking $2,000 video camera and the editing system on your computer, you can make a TV show. Yeah. Now go ahead and do it. Yeah. You know, granted you got to make a living somehow, but it's really like this podcast, obviously, podcasts are a perfect example of that. Like, you can just go ahead and do it, and people can decide if they like it. And, there's too many of them out there. Well, not that people are listening to or watching.
Joe, amateur move.
What?
Chewing gum into the microphone.
Am I doing that? Yeah, you're on. No, I'm so sorry. I took my headphones on because my ears are sweaty because we did a 3-hour podcast before this. And I looked at Greg without his headphones on. I got jealous.
Wait a minute. You've already done a 3-hour podcast?
Yeah, today? Did one, yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
And you'll do stand-up after this.
Hell yeah, son.
Amazing amazing audience again, though. Just another.
Oh, did you just get off stage?
Yeah,
they're fucking super cool. Greg, you're up beautiful. In like 12 minutes, by the
12
way.
12 minutes? I'm going to do stand-up comedy?
Yeah.
Outstanding.
Maybe closer to 10.
Okay.
Somewhere between 10 and 12.
All right. I'm going to need a topic to open up with.
DirecTV,
you got it.
Yeah, that shit's crazy. Did you guys just talk about that?
What?
Viacom and DirecTV. You guys didn't hear about that?
No.
Yeah, they don't. They've like separated from each other.
Yeah. DirecTV just pulled all the Viacom channels off last night.
It's nuts. The idea. When are you going on stage?
10
Any
minutes?
Second now. 12 Who's on stage right now?
Ari Shaffir.
Ari's on?
Yep.
Damn it, I want to go watch.
Brendan Walsh just contacted me, by the way. He's in Indianapolis at Crackers, and he's going to be there all weekend. But he said a shitload of Death Squad people came up, and he wanted to just, like, thank everyone. He's listening at home right now, or at the hotel.
Nice.
Nice story. Benji, what's up with you? Have you talked at all yet today?
You know, little bits and pieces here and there.
Yeah?
I did get screwed by DirecTV. I just signed a 2-year contract, like, 2 weeks ago.
Awesome.
No, I'm screwed.
Oh, Benji was talking. You did? Why would you go with DirecTV and not like a local cable company?
Because DirecTV seems better. Time Warner seems shady. And every time I call one of those companies, I feel like they're going to start ripping me off. And
he
I just
got DirecTV yesterday, and that happened, and he got a job with Viacom.
I think you have 30 days to try.
Seriously, you really did.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Yes, I did.
He's working on the show. Actually, Joe, I've been working with Chris McGuire.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Doing what?
We're writing Jeff Ross's new show that's airing on August 14th on Comedy Central called The Burn.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Been having fun.
Yeah, it's pretty much the roast every week now, right? Is that what it is? Or what's the idea of the show?
It's sort of like an insult-laden fun fest where not just necessarily people are being made fun of, but, you know, it's like remotes and experimental fun out of the studio things, you know, like insulting people that everyone hates. Like he goes and attacks meter maids and lawyers, and he's just like getting justice for the people by making fun of these people, just lambasting them out of nowhere. He rolls up on a Segway and we load him up. Yeah.
What was that move? Was that a sponsor?
No. You know, like old roasting, they always do it from behind a podium.
Oh.
So we figure like the 2012 model of that is to make a podium into a Segway. So he has like a Segway podium.
That's pretty tight.
So he just rolls up and just starts roasting people.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, what is that? Powerful Dirty Martini?
Delaware brings in martinis. Nice. He's a gentleman. Like some sort of James Bond type character.
Yeah.
Did you go up yet?
No, he's after Greg.
I'm up after Greg.
After Greg?
Yeah.
Fitzsimmons?
Yeah, it's Ari, Greg, Dom, you.
I want to go watch Ari. Heard Ari's doing some new shit.
Yeah, didn't he start over from scratch? Isn't recently? Or he started with all new material?
Yeah, after he recorded that album in Colorado.
Yeah. Colorado. There's something I was going to bring up. What was it?
Which reminds me, Brendan Walsh, if you're listening still, remember that name for your new album should be Another Brick in the Walsh.
All in all, we're just another brick in the Walsh.
See, it's got a ring to it.
That was so cool when those kids, we don't need education.
I got to see them on mushrooms at the Ohio State.
Wow.
Horseshoe.
Oh, my.
And it was...
You were at that show? My older brothers, both of them were at that show, and they always tell me about it. That is so fucking hilarious.
They have, like... And it's crazy, because I was tripping the hardest when there was, like, these pigs that come out, these humongous inflatable pigs.
Did you go to a party after that?
Still on right now.
I've been to...
You're on right now.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Is that microphone on?
Yeah.
I took these things off, so I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, it's confusing right now.
I'm just enjoying... Not having sweaty ears.
But they have these humongous inflatable pigs that came out and just pretty much went over the audience, and it felt like the pigs were just attacking everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody. Turn down their mics.
Because of our playing, I changed shafts the other day.
I know, I saw that.
Different cue now. Getting a little better action.
What is that? Is that 19 or 20?
19. I switched to a little lighter cue. Do you ever watch Battlestar Galactica?
Seen a little bit of the first season. Didn't get hooked, though.
God damn, that's a good show.
Yeah, I tried also.
You couldn't get hooked on Battlestar Galactica? No. I could get hooked again. I could go back and watch that shit again.
Yeah, it just didn't do it for me.
Really? Well, you didn't like Spider-Man either, man.
The new
Spider-Man? I fucking thought Spider-Man
the new one?
Was good. Yeah.
You revealed the ending, right?
No.
Shh. What?
You didn't like it?
No. I thought the other one was better.
Wow. I didn't think so.
Really?
Yeah, I like it.
You didn't think...
First of all, the new girl is uncomfortably sexy. She seems like she's like underage.
Emma Stone is one of the most beautiful women's
How old is that girl?
She's of age. And
that's uncomfortable. Why is she playing a goddamn teenager?
Dude, if you thought she was hot in that, she was not even that hot in that. You need to see her in...
She's just hot. But that's like giving you creepy pedo vibes for some 23-year-old hottie. That shit is unnecessary.
She took my place of Lindsay Lohan.
Right?
She took the,
Why the fuck are they the having that girl play a teenager? That's creepy as fuck, man.
Well, she is young.
I agree.
I'm trying to turn you into some fucking weirdo.
She's 88.
She's a sexual woman in her prime, and you make her pretend she's in high school. And she's like, Dad, I'm doing my homework.
Boy.
Well, she's just...
Check her on an Easy A.
Right?
What we're watching today is those little kids. That's fucking sick that they dress up as beauty queens.
Oh, yeah.
And the kids are like doing like stripper moves at 2 and 3.
Yeah.
What's that show called?
Toddlers and Tears.
Toddlers and Tears.
I once read this book called The Disappearance of Childhood, and it's all about how childhood doesn't even really exist anymore.
Well, to those type of stage moms, yeah.
Well, if you look at it, you know, between like Facebook and TV and all the things that people are exposed to as adults and children, what really created childhood as a construct is that information was kept from children, and certain books were just for them, and really it's sort of like adults would be privy to certain information that children weren't. And so really, because all that information is available to everyone, it doesn't really exist anymore.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah, it's like comedian Matt Edgar says, now when a kid's born, somebody takes a picture and posts it on their Facebook. So the first day of their life, their dick's on the internet.
Yeah.
It's a whole new thing.
Yeah, and they shouldn't be making those diapers that look like thongs either. Shit's fucked up.
Right. And they shouldn't have toddlers and tiaras sponsored by a lotion company.
Tony, tempting. Giving us the business.
Lubidur,
no, I don't have toddlers. I don't have toddlers and tiaras material.
Whatever happened to that one girl? They never solved that case. JonBenet Ramsey. They never figured that out, did they?
No, not yet.
They're pretty sure that it was the mom.
Really?
Yeah, they're pretty sure that the mom wrote the ransom note. That you know there was a. Some sort of note that was left behind, and they identified a bunch of key characteristics that were very much like how she wrote her letters. So they're pretty sure it was her. And the problem was Boulder is such a nice place to live that nobody ever deals with homicide cases, and they just completely fucked up the scene of the crime.
Oh.
They ruined all the evidence. Nobody could figure out where the fucking footprints were coming from. Even though there was snow on the ground, they stepped all over everything.
Right.
They fucked the whole thing up. So it became a real big disaster.
I was reading about this couple in Florida, and they had left their cell phone in a Walmart shopping cart. And so someone went through it to return it. Oh, let me find a phone number. And they found all this child pornography of this couple, a man and a woman, abusing children. And they're both in jail right now.
Oh, my God.
So lock your phone.
I should be in jail.
Good advice. Good Solid advice. The pedos out
well,
there.
Well, even if it's not like that kind of shit, if somebody found my phone and just went through my text, like I have this problem now. I just keep on forgetting to delete my text every couple of days, you know. I just save it up. Like you can have whole stories of my relationship with people, you know, for months going back if you read my text. And that's fucked up if you think that not only can they go through all your personal photos, they can go through all your personal conversations with people, they get all your numbers, they got your notes, they got your email, they
and
got
then
your
they start sending you IM, and then next thing you know, you get your freak on. They know, you know, Brian Reichel, I like how you roll. I see all your pictures, you look like you're a fucking partying dude. Can we get freaky together? And the next thing you know, you're on the road. Right?
I have a creepy friend who sends me porn texts every day, and it started jamming up my memory because now my text logs are
porn
full of porn
texts.
I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, you got to delete it. If you have a lot of photos in there, it's taking up your iPhone memory.
Oh,
heads up.
That's why girls always have zero space in their phones. And I'm
all
always
filled
like,
with dick pictures.
Yeah.
The phone's just a fucking swarm of dick pictures, like salmon trying to swim upriver.
I wonder if the black girls' phones go faster because of the length
more
of the dick.
More dick pictures?
No, just...
What are you saying?
Nothing.
Why would black girls' phones fill up faster?
More megabytes on those photos of those dicks.
If I were an app inventor,
bigger dicks have more megabytes.
Yeah,
imagine if like photos were like 3D and a big dick. Like you send a girl a dick picture and she's like, "Jesus Christ, it's 3 megs." She knows what a fat dick this guy's got.
I've been texting people black dicks lately.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite things to do.
Or I walk up to them with a black dick on my phone. I'm like, "Oh, hey, what's up?" Then I go like that, and they're like, "Ah!"
It's great.
It's fun.
It's nonstop fun.
Have some black dicks ready. On
it's
your
great
phone.
For waitresses good at advice. Restaurants.
Get your freak on. Get yo. Freak on. I'm all podcast out.
I am very podcast out, guys.
We had a good day today, though.
Yeah.
Fun day.
And we got
good to see you, lad.
Good to see you, Joe, for fuck's sake.
I can't wait till you go on stage. You going on stage any moment now?
After Greg.
I went to watch some good comedy and shut off my computer. Just getting used to this whole Windows environment.
Thanks for having me, guys. Appreciate it.
Oh, yeah. No problem, man.
Thank you, Joe Rogan.
You're welcome, my brother. I think we're going to shut this thing off, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
It's been a long and crazy road. We're nutty, but we're not that nutty. At a certain point in time...
I think it's the air conditioning thing that killed me. I've
exhausted.
Just been fucking tired from being... It's kind of nice in here now, though. It's not bad.
It's beautiful in here, but we're fucking tired, ladies and gentlemen. We've had a long-ass day. And Brian,
good job
today.
Good job,
fun
yeah.
times.
So Joe, you got to come in and do my podcast.
I do. I want to.
Just give me a Tuesday you're around.
Does anybody know how to make a bookmark on fucking Windows? How do you bookmark something?
You write it down on a piece of paper.
You do. I'm not kidding, man. I don't know how the fuck you bookmark anything. This is sad to me.
All right. Follow Joe on Joe. You're already following Joe. What the fuck?
Yeah. Tell me on Twitter how to bookmark using Google Chrome on Windows.
Dom Herrera.
Appreciate the fuck out of it. Dom Herrera.
On Twitter.
Follow Dom Herrera on Twitter.
At Dom Herrera. Is
that what it is? At Dom Herrera. But you got to spell it to him, Don, because it's a crafty use of the double R's.
DOMIRRERA.
So the double R's are first, ladies yeah. and gentlemen, and you can fuck up, and I have accidentally in the past. No disrespect.
And Greg's Fitz dog? Is that what
I've
it is?
I've had that at clubs I worked at for years. They still really? Misspell my name, yeah.
Double R is first, ladies and gentlemen. Double R is first. I-double-R-E-R-A. Get it together, bitches.
And Greg
is first.
Greg Fitz show.
Yeah, Greg Fitz show.
And are you still Baby Ben or Busy Bench? What are you? Baby Benji?
I'm just Benji Aflalo now.
Oh, that was a portal. Bad idea.
Nice. We do these shows all the time, ladies and gentlemen. So if you're ever in Pasadena and you want to come down and hang out, we have fun times here at the Ice House. It's a great comedy club. It's been around since like 1950. And if you guys want to keep going,
I gotta stop. I'm tired. I really can't do this. I have to go to San Diego.
How long did we do this one? An hour?
Hour and a half.
Oh, that's pretty good.
And Pete C on Twitter.
Me.
Hala.
And Ari Shafir, Aika Tanaka.
Oh, there's a bookmark.
Tony Hinchcliffe.
Tony Hinchcliffe. H plus Hinchcliffe plus C. I'm Brian Redman, and if you want to go to a live show, go to icehousecomedy.com, search for Death Squad. We'll see you in San Diego for the Comic Con at the American Comedy Company starting tomorrow, Friday, and then Nighty Show Saturday. Right, see
Hala.
You
guys.
Later.